When you make it magic, the ingredients don't come with instructions. You just gotta know how to put that shit together.
Key Funk is three dudes: singer, rapper, producer.
Hip hop was never the same after that.
Blues has always been totally American. As American as apple pie. As American as the blues, as American as apple pie, the question is why? Why should the blues be so at home here? Well, America provided the atmosphere.
This is Joe Munroe with EURweb, and we are sitting here with a West Coast legend, Mr. Warren G.
How you doing?
I'm good, how are you?
I'm good.
So, you have a documentary coming out with YouTube, mm-hmm. G-Funk.
Yes, indeed.
Gangster Funk.
Yes, indeed.
So let me ask you, just starting right off, listening to kind of the music today and how it's more melodic, you guys were the start of that, you and 213. Do you think that you guys get enough credit for kind of originating that song, that gangster song type style with the hardcore raps or just rap in general?
It was actually passed down to us. 187 from Above Law and Lay Law, KMG and GOMAC and Chaos was the ones that put me on. You know, made me part of G-Funk. And from there, you know, it was, you know, just G-Funk, you know what I'm saying? So from that, you know, a lot of artists of today, it's incorporated in their music, like Kendrick Lamar's and like YG, and you know, a lot of the artists here on the West Coast, and Ty Dolla $ign, and you know, all the different artists here. From us, you know, making it a worldwide genre, you know, that's the results of it.
So when you were working on that early album and watching the doc, it said that Dre was like, you didn't use any of the stuff that you had worked on with him. You went completely in your own direction. Was that done on purpose because you wanted to separate yourself, or was that just where the music took you at that time?
I was just more on some feel good. You know, I want people to feel good with the music I do. You know, I didn't really want it to be too dark and too hard. I just wanted to let people party and feel good to whatever it was I was doing. And so I just started, you know, doing live instrumentation and using Rhodes and stuff like that, different melodies and stuff that sound good.
You kind of saved Def Jam in that you went platinum in 3 days, which is unheard of currently, like a million copies in 3 days. Do you look at some of the things now with the newer generation, like with streaming numbers, and think that it's not exactly authentic? Not that it's not its own thing, but it's not as pure as hip hop was when you were getting started.
Yeah. I mean, it was, you know, it was a lot of hard work for us back then. We couldn't just hit a button and our music is everywhere, you know what I'm saying? It was really hard. We had to do groundwork, footwork, and even with me and Snoop and Nate on our come up, we used to just get cassettes and dub them. You know, we would dub them so they could get here, and there. And that was just how we did music and how we got it, how we promoted it ourselves, and along with street teams and stuff like that. You know, but nowadays you got, you know, the internet and streaming, and you know, it's a lot easier. A lot of numbers to be tracked digitally. We don't know if how, you know,
because you got to think, like from your day, a million in 3 days, what is that really? Because you know, we were bootlegging back then. We don't know like how much stuff was playing around. Like you think about stuff like that.
Yeah.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it. I loved the documentary. What made you decide to do that? From Straight Outta Compton, or was that something you always had in your mind that you were going to put out a documentary about?
I've always had it, you know, locked in. It's just that a lot of companies was wanted to do it, but they wanted to change a lot, and I wanted to keep it 100% authentic. So I just, you know, just kept, you know, just staying on my own and you know, just saying, you know, until somebody come at me, you know, come to me the right way and don't want to change everything, then I'll do it. But it never happened, so one day I was at I had a show at the Observatory in Orange County, and Carm Gill, who's the director, young cat, he's only 22 years old.
Oh, wow, okay.
I met him, and he did a lot of dope stuff for me. So I was like, man, can you shoot a documentary? And he was like, yeah. So I told him my whole story, laid it out step by step. We put it on paper, and then after that we put it on the storyboard, and then we presented it to my buddy Gary, Bob, Matt, Raphael, who's producers and investors in the project. And from there, the wheels just been spinning, just kept spinning. And all the way up to right now, I'm here doing the interview.
Okay, well, thank you. I'm excited. I think it's going to be really good for everyone to catch up on it.